Welcome to Bags and Boards 57. Buckle up, comic fam. We got some comics to discuss.
There it is. That's it. That's us.
Oh my gosh, Fire Guy Ryan.
How you doing?
My brother, I missed you. Actually, not as much as I did, because we are doing this show like every single week now.
I see you all the time now.
Dude, I watched an incredible movie, and I have to tell you about it. Didn't tell him. Comic fam, this is brand new.
I'm dropping
a bomb on him right now. He doesn't realize that this is coming.
Was it Scooby-Doo 2 Monsters Unleashed?
How'd you know?
I knew it.
No. No, we're going to talk about a movie called...
Scooby-Doo 1?
Fresh.
Okay.
So, I got to paint a picture for you here. Because, comic fam, this is hilarious. Because Sebastian Stan is the main antagonist in this horror movie.
Sold. Cool. I'm in.
So, who is Sebastian Stan?
Black Widow.
That's right.
Natasha Romanoff.
That's right. How'd you know?
I pay attention to credit scenes, Tom. I'm pretty smart.
I don't know any of the actors or actresses. No. Who does he play?
Bucky Barnes.
All right, so we have Bucky Barnes. All right, the Winter Soldier. All right?
Aye.
In a movie where he goes on a date, connects with an individual who finds him through a Tinder type of app. They get together, hit it off really well. They sleep together, Ryan. Mm. Sebastian Stan, right? Like, major Marvel, Disney-friendly actor.
I've been told that I look like him, although...
I can kind of see it. Comic fam, let us know in the chat what you think about Ryan looking like Sebastian Stan. So let me tell you about this story, though, because you got to watch this. It's called Fresh.
Where did you watch this?
I think it's Hulu or something. Okay. Peacock, Paramount, one of the two, one of the four. That I love it all, man. It's how TV should be, man. All right. Sebastian Stan goes on a date. They hook up. It's great. They go on a second date, but instead he says, hey, we're going to go to my house. It's kind of far away.
Red flag.
So he takes her to his house, and they've hit it off. So she's like, she's got puppy love right now. She's really excited. Sebastian Stan drugs the date, chains her in his basement along with other women who are in other rooms.
That's like third date stuff, not second date. You can't do that.
Fire guy, Brian. Terrible.
Yeah, don't do that. It's bad.
Keeps them alive and well fed, taken care of, because he is slowly cutting their limbs off to chop them up, to put them in Ziploc baggies to sell like a subscription service for cannibals. This movie is out. And we got Bucky Barnes playing a sadistic creep, and you need to watch it. And then we're going to talk about it next time you're on the show. Comic fam, it's podcast number 47.
57.
I've done that twice today. 57. So I want to know in the chat, has anyone watched this movie, Fresh? It is about cannibalism, Sebastian Stan, and he's doing some crazy stuff. And it's actually really, really good.
Sounds cool.
Yeah, it's wild.
I've watched worse movies in the last week.
All right, I have to know who has seen this. I mean, we have a major Marvel actor doing horror. It got me pretty hyped.
A lot of times I've noticed that they get, like, tired, I think, of doing the same role over and over. So they go out of their way to do a completely different thing. Yeah, like
Jeremy Renner when he went rock and roll star.
Yeah.
Oh, man, we got to do a whole bit on that at some point.
Do we?
It's rough, man. It is cringe. Fantastic. All right. So we have a packed show available on SoundCloud, Spotify, Stitcher, and iTunes. If you're not here with us, we want to remind you, we're doing this show live because we have to get information out to the comic fan, but we do clip the show out. So if you want to watch it, you know, in smaller bits, it'll be available for you. In the future on YouTube, we have comic books we've read, some amazing pacing in a lot of these comics. I'm very hyped to talk about them. We also have comic book restoration to discuss. Jimmy T sent us more things. We get really excited when Jimmy T sends us things.
Is that why he wore this hat?
This is my twisted hat.
Did you specifically pick the hat for the color scheme?
It kind of matches the gold.
The color scheme right there.
Shout out Pops and Vintage now from Twisted. This is the Twisted logo. He's a homie. Anyways, it does match our...
that's what I'm saying.
It kind of goes with it. Maybe they talked. I don't know. So it's a podcast about funny books, expensive paper, but also affordable paper, because you got to do more than collect them. You got to read them. And we're going to talk about what we read as well. Ryan's my homie, and we have this type of discussion all the time. This time it's recorded. And then we made a podcast about it.
That's a good idea.
It's kind of, would you say,
there's like not a synopsis of the show? There. You know, we did our part to add a new one.
No, we're going to talk about Thor, Love, and Thunder. We're going to talk about a bunch of different stuff. So stay tuned. Hit the likes, hit the subscribe button. But first, let me tell you about our first sponsor, the sponsor that makes so much possible. We talking the best new place to buy, to sell collectibles. You know it be whatnot. Take a look at this. This is my profile. Comic Tom 101 over on the best new place to do the things I just said. Follow me on there. We just broke 4,000 followers this past week. Nice. Shooting up in rank. I love it. While we're here, I'm just going to show you. Look at this. On the very bottom here, these are all the current live streams happening while the show is on. There's more than like, I mean, there's a lot, man.
So you're telling them they can leave us.
They can leave. If you want to go and buy comics from that Spider-Man booth, they're right now selling comics. Right now on the app, dollar start auctions that last as little as 15 seconds long. But notice, Heron Heavens and myself, we hit the mic every single Wednesday at 5 p.m. to do a whatnot stream. This week, we're going to have a 252 ASM. Next week, we're bringing Wolverine 1. I have a first Black Bolt. The week after, we're going to have a Mad Love, Harley Quinn's origin, 9.8 with a bunch of other Spidey goodness. We have Silver Age. We have Keys. These are scheduled sales that you can go and bookmark right now. And if you use the link in the description of this video or any of the videos, because all the links are there, and you sign up to the app, if you're brand new to it, after your first purchase, you support the show, we get $10 and you get $10 as a credit to buy more funny books. It's a win-win all around.
The slippery slope is what it is.
Dude, you can't get enough comics. That's true.
It's, they make it too easy to buy things on the app. It's just like,
it actually is. You want to bid. And also consider this too. This is something that I do a lot on my stream. You know, everyone runs their stream differently, but I try to price out my comics so I can talk about it on the mic, let people know approximately what they should go for. I'll straight up tell people to stop bidding on the mic. I'll tell people, hey, if you overbid, I'm adding this $30 book to it. You're just going to get it. And I won't tell them what they're getting until after it's done. So it's one of those things where it's like, we're here to help guide the community and make sure that people are getting the best deals that they can so they're not overpaying. And it's fun. It's a lot of fun. Ryan, you've been doing it.
I have been doing a few whatnot sales on the Mill Geek account.
That's page right.
On Thursdays.
There we go. So come join myself, Mill Geek Comics.
It's your boy, Jem Mint.
Jem Mint, who kicks us off every Wednesday at 2 p.m. tomorrow. Get ready. Go bookmark our shows and get yourself some funny books. We're going to start the show off with an amazing read. Hot damn. It was a good week for comics for us. We randomly pick these and get caught up, and I love every second of it because I like reading comics consecutively. What about you?
Consecutively?
Like issues. Issue over issue. Some people, they have to go through like what Jem Mint does in his reviews, and he has like 20 different comics to read.
Oh, yeah.
And he reads each one.
I mean, I do that too on my channel on Wednesday. I go live.
It's
on my
a lot,
own
dude.
YouTube channel.
I like reading books over time and being able to read in bursts. Three issues.
Of one title.
Five issues. A whole trade.
Right.
Because I'll forget and I have to reread stuff. Like, I don't know, man.
That's how I live my life now.
Is it?
Oh, yeah. I read at least like 20, 25 books every single week.
Yeah, man. It's a lot. I mean, we're reading a lot of books, man.
Not to mention
but
what we read for this show. I'm just talking about my own pull list.
His pull list is grand is what he's saying, comic fan. It is very long, but that's why they're here for. That's why they got to hit the subscribe button.
So what are we doing first?
We're going to do this book first.
We're going to do a book first.
Yeah, we're going to talk about a book. Oh my goodness. Oh, no, we're not.
We're not.
We're not doing the book first. Right? We discussed this before.
We haven't written down.
I see. Comic fan, sorry. I'm a little disorganized. I need your help in the chat. Let me know that I need to be more organized. Be like, just give me a lot of crap for
just
it.
Just berate Tom, and then it'll fix everything.
Hopefully, it does get better in the future. Okay, here we go. We're going to start off with viewer
comments.
This is when you guys comment on our videos and clips, and we talk about it. And then we also have some stuff to share, because Jimmy T sent us stuff, and when we say Jimmy T, we mean...
James Tynan IV.
Oh, my goodness. But the first thing we're going to talk about is David Phelps. He says, First time I have been able to catch this live. Now, Ryan, why did you pick this one? He actually specifically picked this comment because of other comments, but this was like the kindest one.
Sure. There were several comments from our clips, because like you've said multiple times now, we do this live show every Tuesday.
Yes.
And then in the following weeks, we will chop the segments in this show up and release them as standalone clips, but much later than today, right. Which, for the record, today is like April 19th or something. So you might not be seeing the clip of this until early May, mid-May. Who knows?
But there's a reason why we make this video live.
We do it live to get the information out in a pertinent, relatively timely manner. And if you wait to watch for the clips, you might miss some time-sensitive stuff.
Right.
Which we talked about in our James Tynan onion drop
Substack commentary.
We dropped the first of several clips that we'll be doing on the Substack, on James Tynan's Substack specifically.
After that clip landed, and I've actually had my dad, Russ, reach out, they're all signing up, I'm realizing that it's going to be a snowball effect. More and more people are going to join us on this Substack quest, monitoring another part of the media, that the medium of comics that people don't even really understand yet. We're going to be covering this a lot, Comic Fam, and I can't tell you how much you need to be subscribed to some creators on Substack, favorite ones.
We just picked James Tynan because he happens to be my favorite writer.
That's right.
But if you have a favorite writer who's currently working in comics right now, odds are they have some sort of Substack, Patreon.
That's right.
Some way of directly supporting them.
So, speaking of which, that's one of the reasons why we don't make this video in post. Like, we don't edit it down. This is live. What you see is what you get, because we realized it takes so much time to edit an hour and a half podcast. And it's like, we want to make it our best. So then it actually takes a little bit more time because we want to do things, you know, sometimes in more than one take, make sure you get it right.
Yeah,
I said someone's name wrong. Well, you know, it happens on live, but in an edited podcast, we can maybe fix that. What ends up happening is we miss deadlines. We tell you things too late. Another 100 comics came out and it's like, no. We got to just hit the mic when we're ready to hit the mic and hook up the Comic Fam with as much pertinent information as we can. Speaking of which, here's another comment that made me chuckle. This is from Raven Joe. Substack sounds like Scientology without the crazy.
That's part of the reason I didn't sign up for the longest time. Like, you signed up for James Tynan Substack significantly before I did.
Immediately.
Yeah.
I saw where this was going.
It took me a while because I'm like, oh, that's a whole different thing. I don't understand it, so I'm just not going to do it.
So, you're right. The Substack commentary, it was a pretty long clip, and we did a couple of them, and then we dove into some of the value within James Tynan's The Fourth Substack specifically. But the bottom line, to break it down as simple as possible for those who maybe weren't here last time, is that a Substack allows you to support a creator in the writing space traditionally, but you have audio as a piece of content that you can create for your Substack community.
I'm
you can
also
make
a paid
blogs.
Subscriber to Jen Bartel's Substack. She's an artist who I really like.
So there's a lot of visuals there that you can, you know, see comics in the production. Again, it's like Patreon. However, it has a built-in mechanism so that you can do special things. And this is perfect for creators who want to make comic books or do a podcast of sorts, like Scott Snyder, who does this audio comic 101 class. I'm subscribed to that one as well. It's fantastic. Behind the scenes, things like this. It's a full page that you get access to that's constantly being updated. You'll get emails from the creators, and they'll do special things. Sometimes they'll do a live show that only the members are going to have access to. Sometimes the particular recordings or the particular newsletters or whatever, sometimes they're members only and they're reserved for certain people in certain tiers. But then you have creators that are like James Tynan, who's actually creating variants. And different tiers allow you to get early access. And the highest tier gets you super scarce member variants.
And a membership card.
Well, yeah, we also got to mention that we are officially Tiny Onion Club members. So when you hear commentary in the community about this creator and his work, you know, someone's talking about something that's killing the children, I'm not saying that you have to listen to us more than others. What I am saying is that we are official James Tynan IV members.
Correct.
So
This lets us buy whatever we want, anywhere we want. Anywhere we want, we get all kinds
of
perks.
I'm trying to bring this to Starbucks and trying to, it doesn't work, but you know what? I'm still taking pictures of it and doing it on Instagram. I think
it's got to work somewhere. Just keep trying it enough places.
This card, aside from getting you clout in the community for being an official member.
Or ridicule from some people, perhaps.
Yes. It also gets you exclusive merch at conventions, free signatures at conventions, signature series fees that are being waived that the creator typically charges, but he's not going to charge his members. So there's a lot of value there. So we're flexing the card because we are official members. And I just think you need to listen to us a little bit more when we talk about James Tynan because we are official members.
Just listen to everything we say and don't question it.
Yeah, pretty much just to let it digest and see what comes out the other end and trust that it's going
to
be okay.
Don't even let it digest. Just listen to it and say, yes, I will do what they say.
Regurgitate.
Be drones.
Drones. Like a computer.
All
speaking
that to
of
say,
which.
We have boxes. We got boxes.
James Tynan sent us more things.
Tom got one and I somehow got three.
I don't know what's going on. So I think because they got your address first, I get mine later. So I'm excited to see. So you guys start opening. I only got one thing here.
I've been cutting while we've been talking. But
what do you got?
You didn't open it this time, correct? Last time you opened your box
it's sealed.
In advance like
I'm
a little.
Not. Mm. Ryan got pissed at me last show. If you didn't know, Ryan was pissed. Because I opened it up, and I wanted to see if I got my membership card, which I did.
He was a little too excited, and I was also excited, but I kept my word.
I don't know what's in here.
Opened it live on camera.
I have no idea what's in here. I do know I spent a good amount of money on his on the merch site, because there's been more than one exclusive drop that I've purchased stuff from. But you were chatting with the D-Comic Queen. It's D Comic
yes.
Queen, right?
D Comic Queen.
So D Comic Queen on Instagram, a member of the comic fam. She's doing stuff for Shortbox and a bunch of other places.
She's a cool person.
She's really cool. She knows her comics. She has an awesome collection. And she was hyping up The Closet, a title that James Tynan is going to be printing soon. And she was saying how excited she was about it. And I saw the thread and Ryan's like,
I reached out and was like, I already read the first two issues. It's a great book. Because the first issue is coming to print in a couple weeks.
She was like, what? How'd you read that so quick? Because you gotta be a member.
You don't even have to be a super duper gigantic Onion Club member.
This, no.
The lowest tier of Tynan Substack gets you access to all of the comics.
That's right.
Which is like $7 a month or something.
$7 a month. He's updating the comics every other day. There's new stuff coming up because his output is immense. And then some of these are gonna be printed and the community's getting all hyped about stuff.
That
we've already read, so we already know we're gonna like it, and we already know we're gonna buy it.
I've ordered. Yeah, I'm excited for that one.
All right. So first off, I'm looking at what
super
looks to be the same
packaged
thing. We have Third Eye Pull Box free subscription service. Looks like they got a.
This is the site that he does his comics shop. Yeah, all of the web store stuff goes through Third
James
Eye
is trying
comics.
To hit me with some ads here to get some comic books.
Damn him!
It's okay. James can do anything.
He can do it. I'll accept.
All right. This is very secure.
Very secure. I need to pull out the blade again, even though.
I may beat you, Ryan. Risky. All right. Let me see. This is probably the same thing, so I'm excited to see what you got over there.
Ready? I'm going to pull the thing off on camera.
Son of a gun. I can feel a dent. Ugh.
You can feel a dent?
I can already feel a dent. It could have been from me, and I just did it on the damn camera. I don't know.
Ready?
It is what it is. It is what it is.
All right. Still secured.
Son of a gun.
You ruined it?
Yeah, there's a dent.
Let's end the show.
We're going to restart the show. Just kidding. I don't think I did it, too. I think this is how it was, but it's okay. I'm
ooh,
still
that
happy.
Looks good. Oh.
We have our second Nightmare Country, James Tynan, writing Sandman. The dude was on his way out. He's like, you gave me Batman, you gave me Joker. He did what most creators would never do, and they said, no, I'm just going to go into my own thing. And then DC's like, hold up. You want to do Sandman? And he's like, okay, I'll do Sandman. So, hold it up, brother.
I kind of like this one more.
I like it more.
I think I like this more than the Something is Killing the Children one.
So, some members were scoffing at the prices. It's $250 a year for the top tier membership on James Tynan's site, on his Substack. However, you get these gold foil variants, and he promised six of them. I don't know if you get these if you sign up now.
You can. He posted on his most recent update, like yesterday or the day before. If you sign up before the next drop happens, the first week of the month is when all of the new stuff comes out. So as long as you sign up for Substack before the first week of May, you can still lock in one of these with your $250 Onion Club subscription.
So I have a dent
that sucks
in mine.
Where's your dent?
It's right here. It's right around, actually, honestly, dude, it is probably.
Did you do it?
I don't think I did it, but maybe I did. But regardless, I have a spot that I'm going to send it to get fixed. And we're going to talk about that here in a second. You can just feel the spine. You can find it.
Oh, yeah. No, I can see it. It comes out right above the bottom staple.
Son of a gun. All right. It happens.
It's your fault.
Yeah, that's right. Hey, we got the clickbait for the thumbnail. Yay. All right. It's all good. It's how it goes.
Is that a metal cover?
It's a foil gold cover. Comic fam, look at this. It's glorious.
Gold foil. It is. Yeah, I love the trade dress and the banner at the top and like... The Virgin Something is Killing the Children is really cool.
But there's not a whole lot on it. There's a lot of negative space.
Yeah.
This has a trade dress, so it looks kind of cool.
You didn't even get other boxes?
I didn't. What are you... You have to open these quick, dude. You're taking too much time.
You'll probably get this stuff later. I'm assuming this is 2 and 2.
That may just be the... Yeah, that's probably the exclusive that you got. Here, do you want to give me one? They're the same thing.
Probably.
Yeah, I'll give you one here. Let's see what else Ryan got.
I'm also getting another t-shirt.
There's no t-shirt in here, though.
Right? That would be a very weird box to send a t-shirt in. They did not do that last time.
No. I also have t-shirts coming, too.
Yeah, I think this is just 2 and 2.
Yeah, there's 2 and 2, so I'm opening yours up, Ryan. I hope you don't mind.
Just don't dent it.
We got to move the show along, Comic
Fam. Don't dent it. Although, this cover did not sell out as rapidly as the Something is Killing the Children 21 variant he did last month.
But he also did a dealer lot, which was cool, and I was able to order more than, I ordered two of these.
This looks good in person.
Here, so I'll just give you the one. Actually, I'll hold up the one. I haven't got mine yet, but this one right here was another variant that he did for Nightmare Country, and this was a shop exclusive that more people would be able to get. They're available on his site, I believe, still. They may be sold out now.
Last week, you could still buy one of these for $20.
Yeah. So this is just another James Tynan exclusive Corinthian variant. It looks gorgeous. I like it.
This is from Werther Delladera, the Something is Killing the Children artist, who does this shirt.
That's right, man.
Kind of cool that he's got his stable of homies that he uses.
That's right. All right, comic fam. James Tynan IV doing Substack. What's this comment? Because we're still in viewer comments. Harnessing the fight juice. This is the way. This is by Brett Hess. A longtime supporter of the show. Improv. It happens, yo.
That was, we were talking about Donny Cates' Hulk run.
That's right, with Hulk being in the...
Trapped in the engine room.
It's a weird of the starship.
You'll have to watch that video to hopefully understand a little bit more, but probably not much because I was confused. And I said, fight juice?
That's right.
It's a very strange turn of phrase.
It's mental fight juice that the Hulk gets to get him angry so that Bruce Banner can control the Hulk in real time with the persona of the Hulk trapped in a mind jail.
Comic books.
Comic books, yo. Yeah. Let's do it. All right. We have the Infinity One. He said, or they said, I'm glad they cut it from the original. Let's talk about the Joker.
This is a clip we released this morning, actually.
I'm glad they cut it from the original because it would be out of context for Batman to go to a crazed maniac for help in solving a good detective story. This is in reference to what we chatted about last week, which was the deleted scene, which I don't know if we would call that a deleted scene at this point because we don't know if it was actually a deleted scene or just something left on the edit room floor. But there was a scene where we see the Joker in parts in the Batman movie. And whether or not that was, whether or not this was actually part of the franchise or not, we got a glimpse of what they intended, what they planned to use, and they decided to scrub it. But I think he's right.
Yeah.
I think he's right.
I can see why they cut it, especially with, it's been a few weeks since this came out, and the hype of seeing this new Joker has died off a little bit. It's another reason you want to make sure and catch these live shows, because back when we talked about the Joker, it was already... It goes a couple days beyond the point we should have talked about it, but now this clip is coming up several weeks after this whole deleted Joker scene went up.
Well, you know what else happened muy rapido since is we actually have...
this, yeah.
Here, we're going to do this first here. We actually may clip this out separately. So speaking of Joker and the deleted scene, we also got an update on Thor, Love, and Thunder. Here it is.
Is this an official poster?
I think so.
I have not seen this before.
I think it's the official poster, and if it's not, it's going to do a good job.
Looks like it could be.
Just kind of encompassing what we experienced over this last week. We have another Thor movie coming, and I'm very excited. It seems like it's going to have that comedic timing that we were, you know, that we grown to love for the first few movies. And it seems like it's going to be pretty, I don't know. I'm not getting the same level of, this is going to be game changer. You know, it seems like it's going to be more of an enjoyable movie.
You mean as compared to Thor Ragnarok?
Yeah, I mean, the stakes don't seem as high for this movie just yet. And I think it's largely because we haven't seen gore. We haven't seen what Zeus is going to be looking like and doing. Okay. You know what I mean?
I thought you meant more like a meta sense. Like, we'd already gotten a Thor Ragnarok, so we know. Because after those first two Thor movies, you know, it was hard to get excited for a third. And then when that first trailer dropped for Thor Ragnarok, and you realize, like, oh, wow, they're doing something totally different.
Right.
That's what I thought you were going at.
But hot damn, dude. Natalie Portman as Thor.
The fact that she was successfully amazing. Wooed back to this franchise after the first two movies, she was pretty much like, I'm out. I'm good. I don't need to do anymore. And then Taika was just like, wait a minute. Wait a minute. We got an idea. I'm going to bring you back.
Let's do it. You need to come back. Yeah. This is, she's stunning. She looks amazing as Jane Foster.
I was kind of wondering how they were going to pull it off, but this is very comic accurate, and it also looks like it will work very well on screen, too.
Yeah, this is just.
I'm glad they waited till the end of the trailer.
And I also think too that because this was something that was, it was something that was teased for years. Do you remember her going on stage?
She came out at Comic-Con with the hammer, and
And then
then COVID happened.
COVID happened, and then everything was delayed a year and a half. And then also we saw the What If, we got kind of a taste of it. And then now it's here on screen, and I think people aren't as excited as they would have been had there not been as many delays, had there not been as many teases about this happening. We all expect it, but this is the visual. This is the first time we're seeing it, seeing her, and I am very pleased.
I also went through and purposefully read the entire run of this stuff, the Mighty Thor run from Jason Aaron, where she becomes Thor in the long time we've had.
It's really good, too.
It's very much worth a read.
There's a reason why it's like been put on a pedestal.
Yeah, it's solid.
It's a really, really good
one of the best runs of the last 10 years.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Certainly from Marvel, at least.
So we also have some updates. This happened in the last 10 hours. So good job being here for the live show. Over 100 people joining us on our Tuesday podcast.
Thank you.
So we all know about this. This happened. We've seen it. We know it's weird. We're talking about the Legends God of Thunder gore release. Gore the God Butcher. Looking kind of ill and not a good way in this picture. This right here is a toy leak that gives us the first kind of look at what gore is going to be like. Now, we haven't seen final images of the character. However, I would say this has been ridiculed to all hell over the last couple weeks. What do you say?
Yeah. The most obvious one to me being the comparison to Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey. He looks like Death.
Yeah, he does kind of look like Death.
From Bill and Ted 2.
A little bit.
I love the fact that we got the Necro Sword in here. That seems to be kind of
overshadowed
by Gore's appearance here. But we got all black, baby.
That's
right. Kind of a king in black.
Yep.
You know, the closest we're going to get probably to seeing
Sir
Cates and Null and all that on screen.
I don't know, man. This could be building up to something.
It was in the comic. This was
and maybe 10
tease.
Years, comic fam. How long did it take for Thanos to wield the Infinity Gauntlet?
Yeah, that's true.
You never know how long it's going to take for these things to happen. But here's something fun. The horrendous commentary about this. It's just like, hey, guys, it's an action figure. It's not going to look that bad. Action figures typically look crappy.
Think of all the crappy, dorky, janky-looking action figures you've seen over the years.
I say this because when the first appearance of Gore, issue 3, right? When that hit the trending list because of this leak, it was selling for $200 less at a 9.8 than it was a year ago at its height, with an increase of copies sold that was in the hundreds. What that means is the book was selling for less than it did, and there's more copies selling now than there ever has been because people started bringing them to eBay to sell to get out of the spec. They wanted to move the comic.
Oh, crap. The figure looks so lame. I want to dump and run.
It's selling for less than it did, and people are trying to sell, and they're selling an abundance of them. So they're bringing it to market.
But that feels like, I feel like this is an example of like the action figure. It looks a little eh, but if you read the book, you know this character is way cooler, regardless of what he looks like here. Also, he's got a hood on in the comic, if I'm not mistaken.
He's got a hood on
so
most
we're getting
of the time.
Like a different.
Yeah, this isn't a good first impression.
To me, this feels like maybe an early version of him before he gets like too corrupted or something and scary looking.
But here's the thing. Jason Aaron.
Yep.
Co-creator of this character.
The writer of that run, yeah.
He did an interview and in the last, 12 hours, gave his commentary and his opinion on the response the community had Would you be so kind, Ryan? It's this paragraph right there while I get this next thing rolling.
Jason Aaron says, we haven't even gotten the first official look at the movie version of Gore the God Butcher yet, Aaron writes. I've seen some concerns online about Gore's design based off of glimpses of the character's action figure. As the guy who co-created him along with Assad, I'll just say that it wasn't Gore's nose, or lack thereof, that made him the tragic and deeply disturbed God Butcher that he was. Trust in the face of Christian Bale. Need I remind you, it's a pretty GD talented face. I don't know if we're swearing on this show, but you know.
You can quote him.
It's a pretty goddamn talented face.
Fire Guy Ryan.
I do appreciate Christian Bale's face.
That's right. So trust in Christian Bale and trust that unless McFarlane Toys is making an action figure, it's probably too soon to complain if you don't like the way it looks. All right, let's get to our first review. It's going to be a good time. Okay, first off, I think I'm going to make a comic book, and I got to poke it a little bit. Matthew Rosenberg, you're awesome. James Tynion, you're awesome. Clearly, we're big fans of the creators who make these amazing comic books, right?
Where are you going with this?
I want to know, what is the longest title we can make for a comic book? Maybe is that the key to making a successful book? Because we have Something is Killing the Children. And right. Today we're talking about what's the furthest place from here?
Yep.
There are, I think the names of comics are getting longer. What are your thoughts, Ryan?
That's six words. There's, meanwhile, Spawn. That's one word.
Ghost Rider.
Two words.
You know what I'm saying?
X-Men. That's like one and a half words.
It's like, where should we go? Do we know where? Is it too late? Based on a true story. Part one of six.
The Comic-Con story.
Exactly. That's where we're headed. All right, here we go. We have What's the Furthest Place from Here? An Image comic book that is fantastic, world building, and you got to add it to your pull list. And there are five issues, and we're not going to spoil it all, but we're going to talk about it right here, right now. What do we got, Ryan?
This is such an interesting cover for an issue one of a book. Like, this is going to be the image that sells you on the series.
Not a great choice.
And this is just a broken down, beat up, post-apocalyptic record store? Is that what it says there?
It is.
Something records?
It's kind of one of those things. When you're making the comic yourself, you kind of just do what you want. What tickles your fancy, right?
This is written by Matthew Rosenberg with art by Tyler Boss.
And this right here is a world that is occupied only by children. And you know what? We have to just give credit where credit's due. The world building in as little as five issues is immense. And being that I've only read three of them, because I had to stop, and I'll tell you why I had to stop. It's something that not many creators are able to do well.
It is kind of impressive seeing how what they're building here. And at first, my impression reading the first issue was like, I'm confused. There's a lot of kids. There's a lot happening. There's a lot that's already happened. I'm not 100% sure what I'm reading or what's going on, but I like what I'm, you know, I like it. I don't know if that, does that make sense? Like, you
Absolutely.
Read something, it can be confusing, but you can still be enjoying it in spite of not knowing everything.
We are in a world that has different gangs of children occupying it. These children were brought to these communities, these small factions, if you would, and they were raised together in a world that is dystopian.
Yeah, post-apocalyptic, I would even say. Dystopian implies that there's like...
Yeah, that's true.
Other people.
Yeah, like, yeah, this is not that.
This is clearly a burnt out remnants of society and crumbling buildings. And these kids live in a record store, in an abandoned record store, and their entire life is based around music.
That's right.
And their whole goal is to find a record that can, like, they can identify with for the rest of their life and, like, symbolizes who they are and you know, their personhood.
That's right. That's actually the third point of the synopsis that I wanted to highlight, is that music is a theme of this book. Matthew Rosenberg has a whole, like, you know, writer's commentary, artist commentary in the back of this comic that he dives deep into music. And you may be surprised, but although Ryan and I do bond over some music tastes, specifically funk music, a little bit of hip hop, a little bit of bad dad rock, we both like to chat about.
We make fun of a lot of the same music, too.
We do. Yeah. But we also enjoy it because it's fun to laugh at, right?
Yes.
Ryan is not a fan of music. You actually have told me before that you hate music.
I don't hate it.
You hate the feeling that it gives you, that good feeling.
Any good feelings, I just don't like.
You don't like it.
That's true.
No, but for real though, like, you're not a music person.
No.
Why?
I wish I knew why. There's something missing inside of my soul. But like, I could think of everybody I've ever grown up with who was always excited to talk about bands or albums that are coming out. And they always grew up walking around with their headphones on or blaring music from their rooms. And
did you ever play any like instruments growing up or anything?
I played played heavy air quotes on that. I played enough guitar to get fine arts credit in high school, and then
you
never
played
did
guitar
it.
In high school.
I played. I looked up some tabs.
Okay.
And I fiddled around with it enough to trick the teacher into thinking I knew what I was doing.
Wow, and then I've never heard this. I didn't know you knew anything on guitar.
No, not even chords.
Okay, so
I was just like plunking along.
Just barely getting by.
Like freaking Final Fantasy music. And then I dropped the guitar forever. And
I think that's a big deal.
Back.
Like if you grow up except listening, for Guitar Hero. If you start playing music as like as a kid, you know, guitar and drums, things like that. I think that's a big part of your discovery of music. But it sounds like for Matthew Rosenberg that he was just, like headphones in all the time and in this commentary. And he was trying to channel that way that people utilize music to accompany other tasks. It sounds like even while drawing and writing.
I'll do music at the gym. Sure. I will listen to music while I'm driving.
Mm-hmm.
But that's kind of it.
One of the first things that we bonded over was our mutual liking, but understanding that it's bad of the Red Hot Chili Peppers.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Like when someone says, oh, Red Hot Chili Peppers are not a good band.
I will not fight for them. I will give them that point.
Sure.
But there's something there.
It's the
DNA that gets me in my soul. And there is something there musically inside of my soul.
You know what it is? Whatever they call it?
What?
It actually is around your kidneys.
It is.
It's called the ketus.
Oh, good Lord.
The ketus is what you like.
No, that, actually, if I could just like splice Anthony Kiedis out of the entire... And just give me Flea and Chad and John on the instruments.
Yeah, you're good.
Anthony Kiedis kills Red Hot Chili Peppers for me. That's a whole different conversation.
Oh,
but.
Man. I want to hear Ryan do a Anthony Kiedis a voice here. Can I get you to give me a little of something? Just a little bit. Give me a taste of your best Anthony Kiedis impression. Come on, Danny California.
Danny
getting
California?
Lost. I'm going to hear it, dude. Channel it. You're
so
live. Over 115 people here today. Come on.
I am live.
Getting born in the state of Mississippi.
That's the lamest. Oh,
no, God. But find something in there. Ryan, comic fam, I want to see you in the chat. Let's give him some motivation. I want to hear him do his best Anthony Kiedis.
Getting born in the state of Mississippi. That's more like Metallica or something. That's not Kiedis. You put me on the spot. That was bad.
You do a little dance and you drink a little water.
Oh, God.
See? All right, we're getting back. We're talking about comic books, comic fan.
Just cut him out of the band and give me the music, the sounds.
We're talking about music.
Can't write lyrics.
One of the reasons why I want to talk about this is because there was something interesting that took place with this comic book. There was a variant, an exclusive, that's kind of hard to get. How many did you guys get at the shop?
I don't even know if we got any of them, to be honest.
You may have gotten one.
People ordered them. You could order this through the catalog. Like, it comes with... is it a 7-inch? Is that what they're
called?
Yeah,
it's a micro.
It's a small record.
Yeah. Comes 7-inch series. Yeah.
It comes with a record that you can play, and it's supposed to have.
It says right there.
What, four songs? That two songs?
It looks like it's
two songs.
Two songs, and it says that they were. It's interpreted, so it's like they have two different songs
versions
that someone covered, probably because you can't just like get the rights to those easily.
Yeah.
So there's two different songs you're supposed to listen to while reading this book. And this isn't the first time that we've heard this, or rather we've seen this happen. We Live was another comic book that really tried to bring in this mixed media experience. But the way they did it is they just uploaded the songs to YouTube and there were skews throughout the pages and you scanned it and it played some music as you're reading about the characters.
There was
traveling.
Another Aftershock book that did that too.
So I have actually stopped reading this series after issue 3 because one, it was really good. Like, we're going to get into a little bit more, but I realized I got to listen to the music while reading this. I want to experience it right because it's that good. It's fun. The fact that we're following a bunch of like kids was the first thing that made me go, I don't know if I'm gonna like this. Because
kids is a little exaggerated. They're teenagers.
Right? Yeah, they're older.
Something happens to them when they turn 18 and they're like either banished or abducted or killed.
That's right.
Something happens to them. It's not quite clear. So the main characters of this book are all, I would say, teenagers.
Yes.
Kids is a little misleading.
That's right.
That implies like elementary school.
Yeah, true. But there are kids in this book.
Sure.
So I mean, but we're following a group that are a bit older. And what we're seeing in this picture is this group who lives at the record store meeting a different gang of teenagers, children. They wear these pig masks. And yeah, it is about...
They live in a bank?
Yeah, and they live in a bank. And the colors are great. And the pacing is superb. And
these are thick books, too. You got to point that out, too. This book is like...
I'm getting to it right here. Because I wanted to showcase the different... This right here is just one example of meeting a different group of characters. But each issue, really, you meet a different gang of kids. Teenagers.
Sure.
And each have their own strangeness in their development.
Theme. They've all got their own like distinct location.
That's right.
This is like a road trip apocalypse kind of story. Oh, good. I'm glad.
So this is why I wanted to get to this part, because this book is like 50 pages or something, like 40 pages.
They're $5 issues. You pay an extra dollar for this book, but it's a thick book.
I think it's less about the actual dialogue and progression of the story and more about the pacing, because this right here is an example of three different pages, isn't it?
Right. So there's like three, basically the same image three different times, but
two.
Oh, you grabbed all three of them. Okay.
And three. Just to give an example, this is 6 pages of comic art, you know? But
it tells to scare you, and these kids are camped out overnight. I guess we should clarify for the audio people. It's this group of our main characters are camped out just laying on the ground in the middle of the woods with nowhere to stay. And overnight, one of them wakes up and notices that a bunch of kind of humanoid-looking creatures are slowly creeping in on them while they sleep. And looks, there's one of them right there. He's like on the pile of kids.
Mm-hmm. They look like animals.
Yeah.
So
but creepy.
So yes, the book is long, but when you're opening up double page spreads over and over again and progressing the story in a matter of like 3 seconds, 20, you know, 10 seconds, it brings you in and it moves so damn quick. Also, the book is kind of sectioned off by chapters, and I love it. This is actually something that James Tynion kind of does in the start of most of the Something is Killing the Children books, where you have an intro, and then it hits you with...
a big title page.
Boom! Something is Killing the Children.
I can hear the music. And the music.
Dum dum. Yeah. It's like Law and Order, dude.
Law
it's
and Order?
Like, I think Law and Order. I know it's terrible.
Insidious.
Yeah, every Insidious.
There's
absolutely.
Like really screeching violins, and it's really scary horror music. I get that soundtrack in my head when I hear that.
But every chapter is a new phase of the book. And I picked this up from, like, I think issue 3 or 4. I can't remember. But, like, I just wanted to show an example of it. And also let you know that what we've noticed is, over time, this negative space starts to get more distressed as the story progresses.
I get the sense there's some kind of image or message they're trying to convey with these chapter title pages. And it's very subtle. And I have no idea what that might be or if that's even a thing at all.
But look at this. I wanted to highlight just the brilliance in communicating sound and the dialogue. The first thing that I wanted to mention was that there is a lot of different characters. And whenever you have individuals in their adolescence, right? Like, you know, younger individuals, it is a slippery slope for me as a reader to like fall into as a grown person writing kids dialogue. Brian, the Bendis effect is what we'll talk about. And I don't mind Bendis.
Bendis actually did the variant cover for issue 1 that I have. The cover B for issue 1 is just a close-up of that pig mask.
What does he say a lot? There's a line that he says a lot that you always complain about.
Oh, my goodness.
It's like, what the heck is going on? I don't know. What is it?
What the actual F?
Yeah, what the actual F? Yeah.
Nobody says that.
No one says that now.
Don't ever use
but
that.
But you see it.
Also,
and it's like,
people need to stop saying chef's kiss.
Yeah,
that bugs the hell out of me.
What is that? Oh, but dude, maybe it's our bias, dude. We're like in our 30s now. Maybe this is how people talk, and we're just...
Yeah, I hate it.
I do not like it.
Or the hand gesture, the chef's kiss, that people actually do it. Like, stop doing it, stop saying it.
Just don't do it. Moving on. So this comic, I do not get that vibe. And if anything, I'm actually surprised how little I feel like it's being forced. If anything, you're being hit with so much dialogue that there's something that is pretty fun that that Matthew Rosenberg does.
This is a
he layers the text.
A three-person creative team. We also have Hassan Otmane Elau on lettering, who is a letterer that I really like.
Gosh, and kills it. Kills it.
The overlapping speech bubbles are really cool. But also in that image you were just showing with him in the hallway, if you can go back to that one.
Right here. Yeah, look at that. Oh, great. Yeah, this is a great example of just example something super creative. Static.
We have a character hearing static coming from down the hall, but
look at this.
He's
right here.
Yeah, it's hard to notice.
But when you're reading it in hand, it's clear.
Yeah.
This right here is static. It's just been blown up, so it's kind of hard to see. It's kind of diluted. But this is all static.
Bubble coming from a door down the hall, and he walks towards it, and you can see the bubble kind of over the top of the door, and inside it is, it's not a white speech bubble. It's just filled with static from like a TV screen.
Right here, look at this. This is a speech bubble, but it's all static.
That's so cool.
It's brilliant. So the lettering and the choice of like when to use letters and not when to use sounds and imagery for sounds, it's just really on point. We have a person who's part of the group who goes missing, and this is this group of
and we've barely even talked about the plot.
Brief, we don't have to though.
Right.
But this faction needs to go and find their group member. They also are led to believe that maybe there's more in this world than what they have grown to know. And there are these beings called the Strangers that are kind of lurking in the background, pulling strings. And we don't really know what they're there for, but we do know that they have influence on everything. They're controlling some of these situations. And we're led to believe that all of these now teenagers growing into adulthood before something happens to them and they, you know, die or get banished, that they were brought there by this other being in a world that's post-apocalyptic. This is like United States. We have helicopters in the streets kind of situation.
And American records that they are clearly flipping through. It seems to be a U.S. record store.
Yes.
With a lot of, if you look closely, you can recognize the albums and the artists. And I'm assuming for somebody who really loves music, that would be a really cool sequence to read.
I'm thinking so. So I think the big reveal, which we don't even know is a reveal yet, and we're not going to talk about the specifics, is how did they get to this point? How did this future take place? The hints within the five issues,
I love it,
is my favorite part of this run.
Yeah.
It is out there. It is a shocking twist that you're not really sure if we're seeing what actually took place or not, but I'm in it to win it. I want to experience this book with the record. Matthew Rosenberg, well done.
There's a spot in the back. I sent you a picture of, there's a letters page, or an interview with the creators in the back of issue one when they're asking each other. It's kind of like a discussion between the creators, and they're asking each other, what sort of records do you listen to while you read comics? And I sent you a photo of it.
You sent me a lot, and you weren't impressed.
I sent Tom a photo of it, and I was like, read comics with earplugs in to block out all noise. Like, I don't listen to music. I don't listen to anything because I want to focus.
It's like the opposite effect. You don't even want to be tainted a little bit. Mm-mm. You want to have the full silence. Do you listen to like...
I can't focus. If there's music on, I can't focus. I'll listen to the music. Even if there's no words.
It has to be a certain type of music for me to be able to enjoy at the same time. Because you're right. It's really tough to keep it organized and to read.
It puts me in a different mood or whatever. Even if it's like Bach or Beethoven or some kind of super classical old stuff. Like, I can't do it. I can't focus.
All right, comic fam. We want to know your thoughts. Have you read this book? Have you read What's the Furthest Place from Here? Also, do you think that comic book titles need to be longer than they've become? We want to know your thoughts. Let us know in the comment section below. And in the meantime, we're going to tell you about a new sponsor of the show, Hot Damn. Yes, after 4 years, we brought on our first sponsor, our only sponsor, Whatnot. Yeah, we have affiliate links, you know, and work with other companies. But as far as sponsorships go, we are sponsored by Whatnot. We already told them about that. Well, 4 years have gone by. We're going into our fifth year, and we found our second sponsor. And we're going to tell you about them right here, right now, because they're fantastic. And I encourage the community to seriously consider utilizing their services. Let's welcome Hero Restoration to the show. Hero Restoration is an amazing company that does restoration, pressing, and cleaning. And this is a thing that I personally do myself. I don't do restoration myself because that's like rebuilding comics, you know, getting that purple label, but doing it with purpose. You know, you want to make some of the low grade comics as best looking as you can if they're scarce enough, if they're valuable enough. However, something that Hero Restoration does is a job that is so damn good that I've been following them for over a year and I've kind of been just scouting them out because in the last 4 years, I've been asked, who's my recommendation for pressing and cleaning? And here's the thing. This is like really how it goes. Pressing and cleaning is an art form. It takes so much practice and expertise to get good at it to the point where you will provide someone your Hulk 181 to mess with, right? It's a pretty big deal.
Yeah.
And there's only so much time that someone has, an artist who does this, right? Per comic book. So in the 4 years, what ends up happening is I get asked, who do I recommend? And that person who I recommend, they stop taking business after a certain amount of time. And I'm not talking about because I said something. I just mean they're doing so well. And as soon as they're doing well, they get so bombarded with so much business that unless they grow their business and hire new people and train new people, the wait times are so long that it really now turns into who's your person that you got? And you got to take care of them. You got to like make that relationship
like
really good.
The movie Fresh. You know, you have to like find a guy and keep them chained up in your basement. And they're your pressing, cleaning guy.
It's kind of what it's like, brother.
Right. The second they get out into the world and people know them, then, you know, it's a one book at a time situation. So I can very easily see this getting out of hand quick.
It does. And it made it so that I just don't have example or I don't have individuals to recommend. And even like pressers that I know who do stuff for me sometimes, if it's like too big of a job, they don't want to take more business. They're busy enough just hooking their friends up in their community. So you got to like hunt for the right person. There's always a risk involved. It ends up being like, hey, send it to like the big companies or don't send it at all or do it yourself, ruin your book potentially. So Hero Restoration is a company that's been growing over the years. I've been watching their pressers and cleaners and their artists who restore comics just perform just straight up alchemy. Just it's amazing what they're able to do. And I pulled up their price sheet. I pulled up their turnaround times. And I'm just like, people need to see what this place can offer. Because I personally think that if you enjoy the comic collectible hobby enough, eventually you may want to get into pressing and cleaning, like dry cleaning and stuff. Now, will you want to get to the point where you're doing giant size X-Men ones and like square bound books?
I'm too nervous for that.
I'm too nervous for that. And I've been pressing for over 10 years, dude. Yeah,
hard pass.
it like really hard for at least 10, but doing it longer than 10 years. I don't even want to press everything. And there's a point where it's like, I want a professional to handle it. And that's where I use Hero Restoration. But I want to show the community their services and show you a little piece about a little bit about what they can do. So if we look at their pressing specifically, because we can have a whole conversation about dry cleaning. We have a whole conversation about restoration itself. But let's get to just the main thing here, which is their pricing, their turnaround times, and what they're able to accomplish. So first off, we got some before and afters. Take a look at this Thor Galactus book. It's amazing. We're looking at Thor 169, negative space Galactus with countless, well, actually you could probably count them, but near countless amount of shots, Kirby goodness in the background of this book, a classic Galactus key, the monster and the man god. Amazing. But what you'll notice on this comic book is that the spine has a lot of damage. So I want you to remember that spine. I also want you to take a look at the negative space in
the Galactus. Can you zoom in a little bit on the Galactus itself?
Hell yeah, man. Look at this.
Oh yeah. Yeah. The white catches dirt.
That's right. Even in the yellow, you can kind of see some grime on there. And we're looking at the left of this book here, and I want you to recall, there's only so much you can do to fix a book, but you're seeing a good amount of spine that has damage. Now,
take care of your comics.
What Hero Restoration does is it's a damn miracle. Look at that before and after. I'm going to do it one more time here for you. Before, look at the spine. After. Before, after. That right there is a spine repair. They fixed the alignment of the book. I have pictures of the back that you can see it here pretty soon. So I'll just let the community know, for those of you who aren't aware, that fixing the alignment of your book is one of the best ways to better eye appeal and to possibly get a grain bump, in my opinion. Because one, you're able to really press out any defects on the spine. And by fixing the alignment of the comic book, it moves the errors that's present on the comic book, that's visible on the comic book, to the back of the book. What do I mean by that?
Ooh.
Look at this page.
Yeah.
This is the back of this book. And what we're looking at is a lot of grime, a lot of dirt. And you see the spine roll. Look at the pages on the left side of the comic.
It's easier to spot on the back.
But now look at the after picture. Boom.
Much better.
It's amazing. Look at how much wider it is. There's only so much you can do.
There's
but
a big crease up there at the top that you can't fix.
There's some things you can't fix, but you can really tone it down, clean it up. And remember how I was saying that there was problems on the front cover? This stuff right here. Well, look at the back. It gets moved to the back just enough when the alignment's fixed. It gets pressed out. It gets cleaned. This right here looks better than the book did before. And this is what was present, looking worse on the front of the book prior to Hero Restoration. So certain books deserve this kind of care. And I'll tell you, as someone who's been pressing for as long as I have, this is not easy to do. It takes multiple presses sometimes if you're not an expert. And take a look at this bottom left. It's night and day. This is how you upgrade a comic, and you want an expert to be on it when it's a certain caliber of comic book. I also encourage people to try it themselves, but not with expensive books, not with books that you really care about. I don't press books that I'm not worried to screw up.
That's a good point. Go practice and find something that's been really beat up, but something that's super common that you won't like completely lose your life savings if you mangle a restoration or pressing on it.
Now we're looking at a Fantastic Four 25, classic Hulk versus the Thing battle. Again, I want to highlight the spine, because every show, if we start talking about things that you can do for cleaning and pressing, I can spend an entire show talking about that one area, because it depends on the kind of book it is. What era is the book from? What kind of paper was used? Is it modern? There's different steps you need to take with every comic, and it takes someone who's done pressing and cleaning multiple times of this era of book, sometimes this very same book with very similar errors, to get that damn good at it. So look at this before picture, look at the spine, and look how much better this book looks after the spine is adjusted, the comics are aligned, and it was pressed down. It's superb. Boom. Crazy. Absolutely crazy. And I'll tell you, it is very difficult to get this done right. But look at that. You either have this excess paper folding over, you're going to see pages if you turn this book around, and this spine that looks pretty harsh. Boom. Look at the eye appeal. It's night and day. Look at the back cover. Look at how much of that book you're able to see on a key book. I'll tell you, if this was me, because I don't know their secrets. I don't know what they do. Maybe over time, We'll learn more about the process and we can bring it to the mic. But this comic book, for me, I would have to press this face down, split open, to the point where it was like flat like a pancake.
That's terrifying.
And then align it, do another crease where the new spine's going to be, and press it again, probably steaming it in between all of that so that the paper is malleable. Don't stain the paper. Like, again, this is stuff that I'll tell you, you don't want to do it if you're not a professional. And if you don't enjoy the process and want to get better at it, this right here is an amazing opportunity to have a professional do it. And let's actually show them the services.
It's Hero Restoration. A Bishop in the chat was asking who this is.
We're talking about herorestorationcomics.com. So take a look at this. This right here is their services. And we're going to show you the difference. Look at this. This is what a press job can do. You can take a book that's super wavy, that has a lot of creases.
Can you zoom in a bit?
Yeah, I can zoom in a little bit.
There we go.
Boom. You'll take that book and possibly make it look as clean as this. That's a modern book. This right here is an AF-15. I can tell by this picture right there.
Dork.
Look at this. Yeah, right there.
Ouch.
And look at this. Oh my gosh, it's slick. It's beautiful. Also, they have updated their pricing turnaround times and their they've discounted multiple tiers as of March of this year. So take a look at this. It depends on if you want dry cleaning or not. If you're doing a press only, you're going to wait 29 weeks. It's up to a $400 value and it's $15 a book. Their tiers are different speeds that you would find in a science fiction movie.
Okay, that's what's happening.
So escape pod is, it's going to be your slowest journey, right? It's
I don't even think escape pods have thrusters.
Exactly, right? Ryan. Yeah. You get it. So $400 max value, $15 per item. This is with press only, no dry cleaning. Keep that in mind. It says here if there's no dry cleaning at this tier. However, if you want shuttlecraft, any year, and it says that it's not just press only, which means that you'll get a dry clean. $20 for a book that's valued up to $1,000, you get it in 29 weeks. Teleport is $1,000 up to $30. This is going to be a more expensive book. It's shorter turnaround time, 18 weeks.
It's like a lot shorter though.
A lot shorter, but there's no dry cleaning. Because again, they don't have to put the step into cleaning the book so they can get it done faster. However, if you want dry cleaning, it's an extra $5. Boom. Any year, $1,000, impulse, $35. Then you get into the higher tiers where it's going to be just about speed and value. $1,000 book versus $3,000 book. Oof. 11 weeks versus 6 weeks. $60 versus $100. But here's the big, big deal here that I got to highlight. Captain's chair. No limit. You got a Hulk 181? Don't matter how much that book is worth.
Send in like an Action Comics one. Yep. No limit on the value of the book. Okay.
It literally says no limit here on the value. 4 week turnaround time, $170. If you go through through other pressing and grading services, what you're going to find more times than not, especially for the big ones, it's a percentage of the value of the book, the fair market value. And I think it's like close to 3%. Some of these books are very expensive that people want to get done, and they're paying hundreds and hundreds of dollars, sometimes thousands of dollars, depending on the value of the book. $170, no limit, professional expert handling it, and you're going to get it in 4 weeks.
I appreciate the fact that there's a scale here, too. So if you have like that level of like life-altering comic book, you have an option here. But if you have, you know, something that maybe is more sentimental value and not so much cash money value, you still have a good smaller option here, which I like.
Absolutely. So I want to thank Hero Restoration for being fans of the show. And I appreciate the relationship that we're starting to build, because this is a company that does some damn good work. I'm excited to show off the process more, maybe even stuff that I do, and a little bit of the reasoning of when I say I need an expert personally, because I don't want to touch this thing. And we can maybe see and learn more about the process. I find the art of restoring, pressing, and cleaning so fascinating. There have been times where I'm at a convention, sitting on the, you know, like this, like going to the area where you're waiting in line for people, and I'm just chilling on the floor, chatting with another presser, somebody who does dry cleaning, and we're just shooting the, you know, what was the term? Shooting the breeze or whatever it is.
Sure.
Just chatting. Conversation just going. Talking about different techniques. Talking about mistakes, wins, losses, accomplishments, like things you've learned, different tools that you use, you know, you'll find yourself, if you dabble in this part of the subcategory of collecting where you're getting into the artistry of fixing comic books, that you're going to meet other people who are doing it themselves. And it's like talking to someone who collects comics versus just reads them.
Yeah.
It really is.
And if you have the time and the patience and the passion for it, it's something you could learn yourself and save yourself a whole lot of money if you want to. But you can also save yourself a whole lot of stress and time and heartache and mistakes.
And upgrade your books along the way.
Yeah, exactly.
HeroRestorationComics.com. Notice, restoration is in their name, but if you're doing pressing and cleaning, doesn't necessarily mean your book's going to be coming back as restored. They also provide grading. You know, you have to like through your account, but they will send it to CGC for you. So you don't have to double back and send it again after they press it. No, they'll just send it straight to CGC.
That's nice.
And then you get the books back. So now you have a path forward to get your comics taken care of, and then have CGC or CBCS do their job and then get the books back graded after the job's been done. Restoration, however, is something that they do, but that's going to be reserved for your really expensive books, the books that you love and you want them to look better. There's a lot of reasons people will restore their comics, but you're getting into, you know, different things that's going to get you that purple label, that restored label. And there's reasons to do that. And when we show you in future videos and clips about that process, you are going to be fascinated. You're going to understand why people do it. Because I'm not talking about getting your, you know, hey, let's send in X-Force number one. I want to get this restored. No, no one in their right mind will do that. But if someone has an AF-15 and it's low grade, yeah, you're going to want to look into seeing if you can get some staples reattached. You're going to want to look into seeing if you can get some color touch removed or if you can add some paper because they will use like archival paper. I'm not even sure. I don't want to talk too much about it because I don't know the process. But professionals who will fill in gaps, make the comic whole again to its former glory. Shall we talk more about some comic books, Ryan?
Well, let's do it.
All right, we have another book to talk about. We are going into... Yeah, let's do it. Scout Comics, baby. Let's do it. Use code TOM101 on Scout Comics to get a discount. They're homies. I don't get any money for it. We love Scout. They're an amazing company. Shout out James Hake. You're going to get a discount of some kind. They change the discount. They make it 30% sometimes. Use code TOM101 over there to hook yourself up because Scout Comics is one of the best independent comic companies since Image Comics. I've said that multiple times. Their portfolio is vast and
they
their creative team
stuff.
Is amazing.
Like I've seen like, I'm thinking of like Vault Comics as an indie publisher I like who seems to specialize in like horror.
Right.
But Scout has like pretty much every genre.
When was the last time we read about a superhero comic book about... Or rather, from Scout. Like, we talk about horror books, relationship books.
They don't do a lot of superhero stuff, do they?
I think they
Impossible do. Impossible Jones, kind of?
But even then, it's kind of superhero-y, but that's more anti-hero, villainy right. kind of, you know, humor. Comedy this right here is like, this is a superhero world. It's mature.
Yeah.
I mean, they're smoking pot. They're having sex. Like, not every Scout title is okay for the whole family.
No, just the Scoot books.
That's the Scoot books.
Yeah.
Which we also... are very supportive of the Scoot books. But Distorted, who do we got?
Speaking of Scoot books, did you notice Nate Johnson's name on the inside cover of this book?
I did. He helped put it together.
He's on the design page, the production team.
Yeah, we got homies.
It's just cool. It's so cool to see.
We got homies, comic fam. We got homies.
But the actual creative team of this book, the writer and artist, covered by the thing over there.
Yeah, keep going though.
It's also, I can't remember. I think I'm fairly certain this book is translated.
It could be. I'm getting the name of the creators up here. It's right here. Boom.
I apologize.
Salvatore Vivenzio.
And yeah, that's the writer. And the art is done by Gabriel Falzoni.
There it is. Distorted. This is a superhero tale that I'm very hyped about because I like Scout so much and there's not a whole lot of superhero stuff that is as world building as this. This right here is a change in human beings' evolution similar to the X-Men. They even kind of poke fun at that.
They do directly mention that in here, which is kind of interesting to see.
People are starting to experience having powers, and there are government agencies having to deal with it.
I like how they highlight it here, like the abilities with the blue kind of circle highlighting the hand here. Is it telekinesis?
Yeah, it's telekinesis for sure.
They're changing the radio dial without actually touching it. And I also love the letters here in that bottom panel. Like there's a lot of times in this book where like, I never say this, but like, I like the letters. That doesn't usually come out of my brain.
Well, you don't know, because we have a good letterer, like a really good letterer, not just someone who's getting the job done with placement, but they're going out of their way to make the static.
Right.
Static, you know, we just chatted about that. This right here is another area where I was like constantly stopping in my tracks going, oh, I'm really appreciative of this type of stuff.
That could have just been another speech bubble.
It could have been. They didn't need it. But it makes the comic stand out. We're following two different stories in this run.
It's complex.
And you know what? I would actually, I think that this is an important one to read the synopsis beforehand because otherwise it's kind of confusing.
Yeah, I was confused. I did not take this extra step that you did and read the synopsis of the book.
We are following in one half of the book, a character named James, who is a high school student, into girls, chilling with his friends, smoking ganja. And he's also experiencing an emergence of new powers. He has telekinesis, and he's kind of showing it off to his friends. And yeah, to the point where he's able to snap his fingers and
lock his car.
Lock his car. But
see, I didn't pick up on that. I thought he was just using his keys because they. Mm-hmm. But you could see the snap.
I gotta say too, it flows really well. This is a writer who is working with his artist very closely because they're able to communicate the narrative with not a whole lot of dialogue, and I appreciate that. I feel like it's not he's not like relying on the artist to tell the story. He's doing kind of a Steve Niles type of thing where he's communicating per panel what you need to do to make the story flow, progress. The pacing is stellar.
Yeah, they do a good job in this sequence of outlining this kid's telekinesis without hammering you over the head with it.
Look at this.
It just happens.
Boom.
Like he walks past his sleeping dad in the living room who knocks off a beer bottle on the chair, and the kid just grabs it with telekinesis and puts it back so that it doesn't shatter on the floor and wake his dad up.
And we get a lot of examples of that. He's just learning to use his powers like any kid would. And there's a lot of music in this as well. That was another thing.
Weird connective tissue to the last
part. Why is there so much music in our comics today? All right, but look at this. We have another person named Tom. Ooh. All right, we have a government agent. He's a private eye. And he's working for a government agency whose job it is to find these individuals who have their powers emerging, because we're learning in this world that these powers aren't just as simple as telekinesis or as, you know, fun as moving something around or lighting something on fire.
That's maybe the most interesting thing about this book, is the way it's affecting society at large is like kind of unpredictable.
That's right.
And dangerous at times.
Look at this. We have a character in a story that he's learning about that's like, not character story. We have Tom realizing about an event where this person, when put into a fight or flight mode, exploded and killed a bunch of individuals.
A 5-year-old, it says.
Yeah, 5-year-old.
Yeah. So it's like not just teenagers like X-Men is. It doesn't affect you at puberty. It could be like anybody anywhere all around the world.
Yeah, this is in Brazil, for example.
Yeah, it's very unpredictable. And it really reminded me of Heroes, the TV show. Where you're introduced to a vast amount of characters, all who have different powers. And at the very beginning of the story, you're pretty overwhelmed and kind of confused. Who am I following? Who's this again? What's their power again? What's happening here? Is this person good or bad?
But the thing is that if you go into it knowing that there are two stories playing out parallel to each other,
right,
it makes it make sense a bit more, which is why I think it's an important review to get out there, because I cannot recommend this enough. This is a lot of fun. This is another example of someone who has this distorted gene where it's manifesting powers. Someone working in an office is just getting so pissed that he blew up the entire office floor.
Quite literally with that sound effect.
Yeah, that's what happened. Almost brought the whole thing down. So Tom has to go and deal with some stuff. Clearly he's interested in this person who's putting him on this task because they have a relationship. And let's see here. We are introduced to both characters within 2 issues, because there's only 2 issues that are out. But the antagonist, the worst of the distorted, are what is going to get you really pulled in.
So that's what grabbed me.
Because some of these individuals, they have powers that are like, yeah, this person got really upset, so he just kind of caused a mind bomb kind of thing to go off. This other person blew up in flames, kind of like instant, you know, spontaneous combustion. Okay. Yeah, these are some hardcore powers. Telekinesis, sure. Tom can read people's minds. Awesome. There's a kid who throws up acid like it's freaking alien, you know, a xenomorph.
She kills her dog on accident, right? She gets sick and just like projectile vomits onto her pet and kind of melts her own dog, which
That's
is
right.
horrifying and disgusting all at once and so cool.
But some of these we get introduced to one antagonist specifically.
Yeah, the girl isn't really an antagonist.
She's just a kid who needs help.
Kind of cursed with a horrible power.
Right.
It's not really beneficial. And imagine if that was on your X-Men team, just like someone who barfs.
There is someone on the X-Men team who does that.
Who barfs?
Yeah, Mike Allred's creation, who was in the Deadpool movie.
Oh.
Yeah, he throws up, and that's his thing. Someone in the chat help me. I'm forgetting.
I'm not an X-Men person.
It's like a name. It's like one name. It's like one word. I'm forgetting. Someone in the chat help me. You know what I'm talking about.
Barf.
No, that's not it. But Mike Allred made him. So we have antagonist who is looking to eat other distorted individuals.
Yeah, there's a cannibal guy in this
book. There's a cannibal.
It's scary. It's got like, it gives this book like a weird serial killer kind of horror flavor that I wasn't expecting either. It's a cool mix of things you're used to, like telekinesis and mind reading and stuff you've seen before, mm-hmm. but also with this weird acid vomit cannibal twist that comes out of nowhere that is really unexpected and cool.
Also interesting that this is the second time we talked about cannibalism on the show today.
Weird.
What is happening? We're not even planning this. We just like, we pick these comics because they look interesting. And then we know that we're excited. And then boom, there's just like these threads that we just weave like we're damn Scarlet the Spider, you know? All right, let's do it. We are now going to bring up the next comic that we read because, ah, damn, it was fantastico. We have Ghost Rider. Do people know that there was a new Ghost Rider that dropped last month in February and that they're on issue numero dos?
I hope so.
All right, let's do it. Zeitgeist. No, is that? Yeah, I think it's Zeitgeist.
Is that the name of the barf guy?
Yeah, I think that's his name. All right, so we have Ghost Rider 2022, issue number one, dropping in February. We are on issue number two. Looking forward to issue number three. Writer Benjamin Percy, penciler Joe Bennett, and Corey Smith. This right here is a great jumping on point for anybody who wants to get into Ghost Rider. And I don't always say that with every new number one, but as someone who has read probably a similar amount of Moon Knight to Ghost Rider, spoiler, not very much, I really enjoy this comic book.
Yeah, I think another way I could connect all three of the books we're talking about today is that they're books that I, at first glance, almost didn't try.
True.
I definitely had to like second guess myself and convince myself to pick up What's the Furthest Place from Here. And Ghost Rider is a character I have never cared about. Never seen the movies. I've read a few of the original issues from way back in the day, so I kind of have a little bit of understanding. But with a new number one, I felt like it was time to actually give Ghost Rider a try. And I am so glad I did.
This right here, we got Johnny Blaze back in action, but with a bit of a twist. Because if you, I compared this to two different shows and you kind of were like, oh yeah, dude, I can't even believe I didn't think of that.
I didn't think of one of them.
Because the first thing you said was Moon Knight. This is similar Moon Knight show vibes in that we are second guessing in issue one whether or not what we're seeing is what's actually being experienced by our motorcycle riding, spirit possessed individual, Johnny Blaze. He is tormented.
It's actually like the Moon Knight comic in a way too, because he's like, a lot of this issue is him in therapy, which is a big chunk of the current Moon Knight book as well.
So he has everything. His life is great.
Suspiciously great.
So he was in an accident riding his motorcycle. So he's dealing with some problems, headaches, you know, talking to somebody about his problems, his therapist, right? He's trying to grow from this, but he's got a family. This incident, this crash left him scarred literally and figuratively, and he's trying to grow out of it.
Yeah.
Right. But what's curious is that he has a family. He has kids. He's got a job. He's working with his father-in-law. Like, there's things that are going on.
He's not normally a happy character. Like, things don't usually work out for Johnny Blaze.
So the reason why we bring this up is that it's got these Moon Knight vibes in that, what of this is he actually experiencing? Because this accident is starting to move him in the right direction in parts of his life, but in the other areas, he is seeing things wrong. Things that aren't there. He sees a dog, and it's actually a creature.
Or is it, though?
Or is it?
Like, they specifically cut to this medication that his therapist is having him take. So it makes you question whether or not, like, is he losing his mind? Is he taking the pills so he stops seeing weird, creepy hallucinations? Or are they drugging him with this medicine so he is seeing fake, happy things, and he's really stuck in a horrific kind of hellscape like this? Like, there's terrifying creatures in this book.
It's like John Carpenter vibes.
This looks like, yeah, exactly. This you looks know? Just like The Thing.
It's like The Thing. There's elements of horror in this, which I love that kind of stuff. Body horror is something I always enjoy in comics because I like feeling gross and awkward when reading comics. It's just like, you know, escapism, right? Anything with a bunch of eyes is going to get you a little creeped out, right? So the thing is that he's living this perfect life and he's seeing images like that on real people and animals, but then also it switches back. So you're constantly wondering,
is he crazy? Or, yeah, what is he catching a glimpse of the reality, or is he just tripping?
Well, we don't know. And that's the beauty. Also, this perfect life that he has, is it real? Which is actually similar to WandaVision. Westview.
That was the connection you made that made me kind of go like,
right? It's a bit of both, right? Oh.
There we go. Okay.
I gotcha. So by the end of issue one, in order for Johnny Blaze to break out of this reality that we don't even really know for sure what he's experiencing
yet.
It
could just be an extended psychotic break.
Exactly. Like, that's why I like it.
It's great. I love that too.
We have an idea of where it's headed, where it's going, but in order to get out of this psychotic break, he needs to let go and he needs to go against what he wants to keep the same, which is his love for his family. He cuts his wife's fingers off. He realizes that this isn't right, that this is a prison, and he's got to break out. So that's what he does. He breaks out of it in the most brutal way, takes the wedding ring off the finger he just cut off, throws it in the fire, gets his motorcycle, starts traveling, and becomes the spirit of vengeance.
We're into issue two. Did you grab the, maybe get the shot of him actually?
I'm having to remember in these moments, do I want to do the reveals yet?
Right.
And I want to save it. I want to save it for the community to see. He goes back to becoming the spirit of vengeance. There is a government agency that's having to come out now and figure out how to put a stop to so much paranormal activity that's happening because Ghost Rider's not around.
He's not, they're like intentionally keeping him captive and all of the monsters are kind of having their way in the world. So yeah, there's this special kind of paranormal agency that is tasked with stopping this stuff.
Exactly. So I don't want to get into too much.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm going to stop it right there. This is how we can wrap this up. Where do we think this story is going?
The vibe I got, there's only been two issues so far, and it feels like we're getting like a
Monster of the Week kind of thing.
Monster of the Week.
Demon of the Week.
Via a road trip. Like he's going to be driving all over the place on his motorcycle and solving mysteries and monster crimes along the way, which I'm into.
That's what I want.
Especially based off the strength of these first two issues. If it was handled in a less good way, then I probably wouldn't care as much. But I really loved the way that they were able to establish this world and this character and the psychological angle they're taking with it is really cool.
Are you reading Ghost Rider? If not, I encourage you to pick up the first two issues. You won't be disappointed. The second issue takes place in a hotel outside of this town that we were talking about. We're not going to tell you anything about it outside of something nefarious is going on behind the mirrors.
Ooh.
We got to hear your thoughts in the comment section below. Also, I want to remind the community that'll enter you to win this Omni-Man Invincible number one. We're going to pull a winner for this in the future, and we're going to source a random comment from all of our videos. So if you comment on every video, you're only increasing your odds that you will get it. And no worries, we like to do surprise giveaways too. So the more you comment, the better the odds will be in your favor. Also, if you want to support the show, I got to hit you with the last plug. It's the most important one that I can do. Not that I don't love Whatnot and Hero Restoration, shout out. But this is our way to send you comics directly from us. Give us an excuse to send you funny books. We have the ComicTom101.com access point for you to join the May Mystery Mail Call.
You will allow me to have a job.
That's right.
Which is very thankful for that, so thank you.
Yeah, if you ever wonder how we are able to get these comic books put together and sent to you every single month, because this is a subscription, you can thank our team, Fire Guy Ryan, who's our sorter. He's the one who makes sure that these books go in there and that everyone gets appropriate amount of love in each box. One per box. We're getting you ready for Boys Season 3. It's going to start in June. So we have Boys Issue 7 from the original run. We're taking the OG Ennis run back to press to do a reprint. And we have a Ben Temple Smith Starlight cover. And because we're able to go do this through Dynamite, we're able to do more than one version of the book, which is why you see a yellow version, a red version, and a painted cover. Ben Temple Smith does his artwork in phases. He'll do a painted cover. Sometimes it'll just be black and white. Then he'll So it's like kind of a sketch cover first. Then he paints it. Then he brings it into the computer and does mixed media work. I always thought, if we can, we need to do more than one cover for Ben Templesmith art, because that painted piece deserves to be printed on a comic.
Lets you see the progression that he does. It's kind of cool.
So if you get an alt variant of the book, because you're only going to get one, not all of them, they are going to be lower print as it goes. And you can go to comictown101.com/print count to see what those final print count numbers are. We update those after the mail call so we can have the perfect accounting for you. We also have other random books that we send in there, but this is the one that we have announced right now. It's also the first appearance of Stormfront, who it will return in Boys Season 3. It's who the character was modeled after.
Yeah, and what is issue 7? Is that like the first part of the second story arc?
It's the first, yeah. I think it is the first part of the second story arc because they introduced Stormfront in it. Yeah, that would make sense.
I need to go back and reread the Boys. I still haven't seen the show, but.
Which is terrible. You got to watch the show. Yeah. Comic fam, what do you think about Ryan always being so slow on getting to the shows that are popping? We appreciate your time today. We've done a lot. We've read comics. We showed you restoration, like repair work and spine correction and dry cleaning. We talked to you about a world that's filled only with adolescents and like children taking over factions. We talked to you about a new superhero world with cannibals. Specifically talked about cannibalism a little too much on this show. We got to know
enough.
Your thoughts.
Not enough. We should have an all cannibal show sometime.
We did a Jimmy T unboxing. We got some exclusives. We talked to you about Substack and so much more. If there's one thing you can do, it's one thing. Hit the like, slap the subscribe. But there's one very, very, very important thing you got to do every single week.
And what's that, Tom? That's geeking responsibly.
That's right. We appreciate your time today. Have a great week. I screwed that up. As always, you said geek responsibly. We out.
We're done.
Woo! Podcast number 57 in the bag. We appreciate your time.
I also forgot to mention this is the post show.
Yeah, we're in the post show.
I forgot to mention that I'm doing tomorrow.
Oh, Ryan.
I'm going live.
Talk about it.
I've got my own YouTube channel.
That's right.
I just put up a video yesterday, actually, of my favorite books from last month, my five favorite comics. But every Wednesday, I also go live and show off my pull list that I get every single week from the comic shop, and I give you my thoughts. But I'm not as fun. I need Tom. I need my better half to keep me upbeat and as entertaining as I am, because I'm very fun, but not when I'm by myself.
Go follow Fire Guy Ryan. You're doing comic book themed content over there, and you're also on Instagram, Fire Guy Ryan.
Correct.
You're also doing like mail call behind the scenes, etc. I saw someone in the chat mention like how many books go in the box. Anywhere between 4 to 7 books. We also send out prints randomly. We also send out digital comics sometimes. They're not going in this month or next month. You guys gotta also know this is something I don't really talk about on the show much, but hey, for the 100 people and the members, it's good for you guys to know. We are in a crazy, crazy time for printing comics. We're like a year and a half in to the ramifications of pandemic. Paper, plastic shortages. You notice that your Marvel comics don't feel as good?
I've noticed.
I've seen people complain about Marvel comics not feeling as good.
And they weren't that great.
You need to be freaking quiet.
Yeah.
You need to be grateful that those are even being made. The fact that we even have paper to print crappy, to print on crappy paper. I will take crappy paper over nothing.
Sure.
So, yeah, That's just fair. What it is. It's what it is, comic fam. It's very tough. We have books that are being delayed by weeks. We have books that aren't even coming out. There's books that are getting canceled. Image isn't even doing second printings right now because they can't get paper. There are members who can't, like, we had to buy a year and a half worth of bags because we couldn't get bags made because there's no plastic. So it's a very difficult time to put this together, to bring you comics every single month. We need your support now more than ever. Like, please join the mail call. We're really going out of our way. The fact that we're able to make new covers, to employ artists to make original art, it's a tough thing right now, and we're doing it for you guys. So join the community, support what we do, and get yourself some dope-ass comic books. You're gonna enjoy them.
You will.
Or else.
Or else. It's not a guarantee, it's a threat. You will enjoy them.